Welcome to the Loyola Greyhound Podcast. I'm Jason Johnson, the Director of Video Production for Loyola Athletics. Join us as our guests will range from coaches, trainers, athletic administrators, and student athletes. Today, I'm excited to have head men's basketball coach Tavaras Hardy on the podcast. Tavaras was an all-Big Ten player at Northwestern University as a collegiate athlete, and he spent two seasons on the coaching staff at Georgia Tech before coming to Loyola as head coach in 2018. Hardy's Greyhounds showed immediate strides on the court during his first seasons at Loyola, including improvements in the overall record and in Patriot League play with significant gains. But what is exciting and timely about this conversation with Coach Hardy is that when he came to Loyola in 2018, he introduced the term Loyola GREAT, an acronym for how he envisioned building a program and the young men involved. His leadership here at Loyola and in our community when it comes to having conversations about social justice, especially in these current times, is needed, welcomed, and appreciated. There is no doubt that this is a Loyola Greyhounds podcast for the books. So here we go with Coach Tavaras Hardy. Hey, Coach, how you doing?
I'm doing well. Just, anxious to get back on the court with the fellas. I've enjoyed this time to be home with the family, but I miss our guys, and we had a lot of work to do. So just want to get back to it and get this stuff back to as normal as we can have it.
Is there a set schedule for that yet when you get to go back or gather as a team or anything like that?
Yeah, so, you know, obviously we're linked in with everyone else in terms of, our local guys being able to come on campus next week. And then for men's and women's basketball, we're targeting the date towards the end of September to get everyone back on campus because as of now, and now I think it's going to happen, our season's going to be played. Everyone knows in college athletics that you need your men's basketball tournament, you need your women's basketball. So, I think from a financial standpoint, there's a big push to try to get that played as long as we can do it safely.
And what's your feelings on that? Do you feel like the safety precautions that are put in place, are you happy with them? How do the players feel about that?
Yeah, I think that, you think about it, the school had the processes down to a level where they felt comfortable. It's just, you're talking about close to 4,000 people, whereas, with us in women's basketball, you're talking more like 30 people. And so I feel very confident that the protocols that they were planning for 4,000 will be effective for us 30, and we just got to be diligent. We got to be tough on our guys in terms of making sure that they're doing what they're supposed to do. But they're hungry. They want to be here and they understand it. And they see, the good thing we all have going is watching the NBA model. And, it's shown that you can do it safely, but you got to be very disciplined.
With having some of the international students on our team, what's their current situation right now, and how does that shape moving forward?
Yeah, so it's a unique situation for all three who would be on the team this year. So Santi and Golden, who were freshmen last year, coming back for their sophomore seasons, they're like everyone else on our team. Whether it's them, whether it's our Brent Holcomb in Miami or Isaiah Hart in Atlanta. They're all staying home and doing what they're supposed to do, taking classes online, the virtual classes, and, working out as they can, safely in their home environment. So they've all been on that same protocol, Europeans and Americans. Those guys will be coming back over as soon as we're allowed to. That's the plan for the returners. There are no government stipulations that are in their way. And so we just got to get him back. Now for our incoming freshman, Alonzo, his situation is a little different because of the protocols of our government. With us being all virtual, he can't come to campus until classes are being taken on campus. And so, we got to prepare for that. We got to plan for that. But he understands it, and he's excited for when his time will come, when he can get here.
How have you been able to connect with them virtually through all this? How are they staying in shape? How are you talking with them about how the shape of the team is going to be? How's that been going?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we've taken a stance that we're not going to overdo it. You know, we have weekly meetings, one weekly Zoom meeting, and it's been very effective and productive. We've covered a lot of topics. Some days we come in and, you know, we talk offense and we watch film. Some days we talk defense and watch film. You know, other days we come in and we talk, you know, life. We've done, you know, we really utilized the breakout room function a lot, and it's been very effective for us just in terms of getting them to talk to each other about different things going on. And again, sometimes it's basketball, sometimes it's culture, sometimes it's, you know, just, you know, the issues of today, social justice. We've covered the whole gamut, and you know, the guys have been really, really enthused each session, and you know, all of them. We haven't had one bad Zoom session. Maybe the first one when, you know, they were a little quiet, just getting used to it. But after that, they've been very open, and we've gotten some great stuff out of them.
What you were talking about, that's a good segue into something else I wanted to mention. When you first got here in 2018, you introduced the term Loyola Great. What's that acronym mean, and how have you envisioned building a program based around that?
Yeah. And so when you look at Loyola as a university, as an institution, you know, it offers so many things, the basketball, the academics, the city of Baltimore. I just feel like at a place like Loyola, and it's, you know, it's also based off my experiences at the other places I've been, you have to pursue greatness in everything that you do. It's a leave no stone unturned situation. And that's our advantage. That's what we offer our student athletes. And so that's what we push them to be great in everything that they do. And so there's four pillars that we really concentrate on in terms of that pursuit of greatness. And first and foremost, I hate to put it first, because I know as an institution, you don't want to say this, but these are 18 to 22-year-old young men, and athletics is at the top of their minds. And so we don't shy away from that. We want to be great athletically. We want to win championships. We want them to want to be pros, and then to go off and do that and pursue that with the highest intensity. And so that's the first part of what we talk about when in terms of being great. Academics, it's equally important. We don't shy away from that. We're unapologetic that we want guys to be great students. Now, you know, not everyone's coming in from the exact same background. Not everyone's moms was a doctor and dad's was a lawyer. And so there's levels to greatness, but we want people to be as great as they can possibly be. And we've been able to push guys to that academically. The other two pillars that we talk about quite often is be great leaders. I want our guys, when this is all said and done, to go out into the world and be ready to have a positive effect on their communities. And take on leadership positions. And, you know, we also encourage that on campus. Kevon Scott last year was a great example of someone who really bought into that idea of being elected president of SAC and also a member of the Green and Gray Society. And then the fourth one is that impact on the community. Directly while you're here at Loyola and beyond, we want to have a positive effect on all the communities that we touch, the Loyola athletic community, the student body. We want our alumni to feel good about us and what we're doing. But we also want to get out into the city of Baltimore and see if we can help make a difference, because there's so many opportunities and needs. And we have great young men that can be great examples. So that's the basis of it. And then, you know, to the specifics of the words, we've used the word great to sort of instill our core values. And so grind, we use the G. It goes self-explanatory, work hard in everything that you do, responsible. You know, you got to take ownership. You can't point fingers and blame people. You got to be responsible for your actions and your teammates' actions. Enthusiastic. You can't be great in anything if you're not enthusiastic about it. So come with some enthusiasm and passion in what you're doing. Appreciative. We're servants, and we have to be appreciative of this opportunity to serve, and appreciative of the service of others. And then the last one, the tenacious, you know, we have big goals and big dreams. And you have to pursue those with the tenacity. You can't just expect to do the bare minimum or just enough. You gotta go crazy. And that's how we talk about, you know, just having that tenacious mindset. And it's okay to dream big, but you better go after it with the respect that it deserves.
I think that some people that watch Greyhound basketball, especially since you've come in, can see these ideals on the court. In the way that they perform, in the way that they handle themselves when we watch you guys on the court and perform at a high level. How do you get your players to reflect these ideas off the court in a way that the average person maybe doesn't see?
It's important to us, and we talk about it all the time. We have real conversations all the time. I challenge them. And so, you know, one of our big things was pushing our GPA up, and we were able to do that. You know, not just last semester, but for the year as a whole. And, you know, it's not common for men's basketball programs in Division I to have over a 3.0 cumulative GPA. And we fought for it and we got it. So I'm really proud of them and the efforts. You know, they are not just talking trash to each other about who scored the most points and who missed the block out or who got dunked on. They're talking to each other about, you know, what's going on in the classroom and how they've been able to succeed. And so those things are important to us. And then, you know, beyond that, when you talk about impact on the community, you know, we've done a lot of different things. We've been out there and we probably haven't broadcasted it enough, you know, because that's not our purpose. That's not our point to our outside community. But, you know, for our guys, they understand that you know, going to speak at a school or even going to help a school move a classroom or, you know, hanging out with some kids from the Govans neighborhood or, you know, doing Habitat for Humanity, helping rehab a place in Baltimore. You know, those things are all a part of our culture. That's who we are. And we want to continue to seek more opportunities and be even more invested. But it's also, you know, supporting the folks on campus that we want to come support us. And so we've been very visible at other sporting events. We've been very visible at other things on campus beyond athletics. You know, whenever there's, you know, the fashion show, which is phenomenal, put on by Alana Services and the Black Student Union, you know, going to plays, like just being out there and supporting, because to be honest, those things are all great anyway. And so it's entertainment. It's entertainment on your campus. Why not be there? Why not go support, you know, and really lock in and hone in on having the best college experience that you could possibly have? That's what we preach to our guys every day.
And with the events that have been happening in some of our cities across the country right now, the unrest that we're seeing, you're saying that you have conversations with your guys about this, and your team is actually incredibly diverse. I mean, with players from different countries, different backgrounds all over the United States. What are these conversations looking like? How have they evolved during this recent time that's been going on? And how are you taking what you're talking with them and bringing that to your peers and others here at Loyola?
Mm-hmm. No, you mentioned it. We are a very diverse team and we're proud of that. You know, some of the diversity we inherited, some of it we sought. But, you know, we feel like that gives us a well-rounded perspective on the issues that are going on. And I can tell you our guys, you know, it varies person to person, but collectively I would say our guys are frustrated. You know, they're scared in some circumstances. You know, they want our society to do better. And so it's so many things encompassing in that, and that, you know, obviously the issues of today in terms of, you know, I would say, you know, it started, the resurgence of this started with George Floyd, and then moved on Breonna Taylor. I mean, obviously Ahmaud Arbery, but that wasn't by the hand of a law enforcement officer, but still, and now with Jacob Blake, there's just so many things that they're witnessing. That, you know, they don't understand. They don't understand why life isn't valued more, why Black lives aren't valued more. And, you know, within our team, we have those conversations and, you know, this isn't new for us. We've been talking about this stuff since I got here. You know, we talk about how history You can't hide from history. You know, the impacts of slavery and the fact that blacks were brought here in chains, 400 years of oppression, you know, that doesn't just go away. You have to be intentional about breaking down the barriers that are were caused by slavery. And, you know, obviously people take different views, and, you know, the view out there, and we talk about this, we're actually going to talk about this on our Zoom call today, how, you know, many look at is, okay, well, stop complaining about it. You know, you have the same rights and opportunities as everyone else now. Forget about, you know, the past, but you can't forget about the past, because the systemic racism that exists in this country is a direct reflection of that past. And so none of us are complaining. Isaiah Hart had a tweet last night where he said, look, we're not looking for handouts. We're not looking for these fake gestures of support. All we want is equal treatment and equal opportunity. And that's what our guys talk about in our Zoom meetings. And it's interesting because, you know, you get the perspective from our black student athletes, but we have white student athletes, and understanding their thoughts and their opinions on it. And they've been incredibly supportive of their teammates and what they're going through. So, you know, it's just something that we take very seriously as a program. I take it serious as a coach. You know, I'm often torn because, you know, you have to wear multiple hats, and that's understandable in our business. But sometimes I know that my main responsibility, aside from being a good father and husband, is to make sure these student athletes are prepared to be successful and be great in everything that they do. And so it's not mutually exclusive that these issues aren't talked about, but, you know, we can't spend all our time on it because we still got to get better at the game of basketball. And so balancing that is not easy for me as the only black coach in our department, you know, and so it's just something that, you know, have to make sure that I keep pressing, but also have to make sure that our team is good, because, you know, that's what I was brought here for. And again, I don't think it's mutually exclusive, but that balancing act is not easy.
When you mentioned Isaiah Hart having the tweet that you mentioned, how do you encourage and support a player's ability to speak out? Because I would think that some players are maybe nervous about what to say. They don't want to get into, I would think, a situation where, you know, you have trolls when it comes to internet and things like that. And they want to represent the university well, but they also want their voice to be heard. So I can understand that maybe they can kind of get in this feeling of like, I don't quite know what to do in these situations. So how do you encourage them to be able to speak their mind, represent the university well, represent themselves well, represent their background well? How has that conversation been?
Yeah, you know, one thing I try not to, I definitely don't dictate to them what to say, when to say it, how to say it. You know, we have standards. We have standards on, you know, just, you know, we don't wear hats and do-rags and things like that in rooms inside. You know, it's just something that's important to me. It's professionalism. And I challenge them to be professionals with their social media. And so I don't mind them voicing their opinion. I want them to do it respectfully, you know, eliminate the vulgar language. Obviously, emotions can get high. And as you said, you know, when you put something on the internet, it's there for everyone to see, and not everyone's going to agree with you. And so, you know, I want our guys to be prepared to defend their positions. You know, and, you know, it's just one of those things. I have to think about it myself. You know, I've probably tweeted more recently, and, you know, I've been sort of letting my guard down in some ways. And it's probably more driven by the fact that, you know, we're not on the court for 4 hours a day with our guys. And so you have more time to gather your thoughts and get them out there. I made the decision. I don't mind my position being known. I don't force my position on our players. That's not what we're about. I want them to have their own ideals. But I want people to know who I am. And I don't hide from it. You know, I feel like my experiences, my background, you know, allow me to think about things in a way where I do consider everyone who it may affect. And but if it's my thoughts, it's my opinion, you know, I'm going to voice it. And that's how I want our guys to be as well. I want them to be thoughtful. I want them to be, you know, mindful of the folks that their thoughts and opinions may affect, but be themselves. And as long as you're doing it with respect, you know, I have no problem with it.
Are there things that Loyola basketball, the university, and just other college basketball coaches that you have talked with, are there things that they have done where they're committed to having this change in social justice or voicing the need for this change, things that may have happened, are happening, or will be happening soon? What's kind of going on from your perspective in there?
Yeah. I mean, nationally, there's been a lot of great things coming out. You know, there are a bunch of organizations that are formulating to attack certain issues and attack systemic issues within our space. It's happening at the coaches level. It's happening at the student athlete level. It's happening at league level. Patriot League has the Anti-Racism Commission that myself and our athletic director, Donna Woodruff, and you know, many other members of the Loyola community are a part of. And, you know, it's an incredible opportunity to look at everything from a 360 view. You're talking policies that can be affected. You're talking, you know, just personal relationships and conversations that can occur. You're talking, you know, voting, just so many different things, so many different different avenues have emerged from these events in the last several months. What I can tell you is our players, you know, they're very intentional with what they want to do. And they're actually in the process of formulating our plan. And we've talked about it a lot. You know, I know a lot of statements have gone out. And you know, one thing we've said was when we release a statement, there has to be action tied to it. And that's one thing for us is we want real action. And for us, we're going to start it with real talk and a real conversation with our basketball program. We want to invite the Loyola community, Loyola athletic community in particular, student athletes, coaches, administrators, to come witness one of the teams on your campus that's dealing with all these issues, again, from a 360 view, and get some perspective. And so September 12th, 1 o'clock, we haven't fully announced it all the way yet, so I'm breaking the news right now, but we're going to have an opportunity to have a real conversation. And, you know, there is going to be interaction. You know, none of us are trying to, again, impose our will on other people, but we want to talk about things and sort of talk about it from a perspective of how our basketball program, you know, has to deal with these things on a consistent basis. So, you know, those are things, and the guys have a lot of other action items that we're pursuing and we're formulating, and just be on the lookout, because we definitely are looking to make a difference in the best way that we can.
That's fantastic that you're fostering a culture of conversation and clear communication. Talking a little bit about what you said earlier, that you're having to have these conversations with your athletes, but also you need to focus on basketball. How much are you guys itching to finally get onto the court and actually get together as a team, be together as a team, start practicing, and ultimately competition? How are you doing with dealing with that nervousness or excitement, it just itching to get out of the home onto the court?
Yeah, it's an incredible excitement. I mean, JC, you got to think about, you know, there were 7 weeks that we missed out on in the spring. You know, we had literally just had our team meeting and we challenged the guys in certain areas that, you know, we need to improve. After the season, there's always a break we give them, and we take that time as a staff to sort of reflect and dig into some of the things that we need to start to improve upon. And so we had a great plan put together, and then the next day we had to send everyone home. and so we missed out on that 7 weeks that we can't get back. And then we're allowed 8 weeks in the summer with summer access. And, you know, obviously the pandemic didn't allow for that this year. And so, you know, a lot of schools throughout the country did utilize that summer access when the NCAA opened it up. No school in our league did. But schools in our league have guys back on campus now. And so, you know, it's just one of those things for us that we're eager to get back to work. We have all these plans that we put together. And you know, the thing about the summer, without having that access, we kept digging in further and further and further into things that we did great and things that we need to do better. And you know, we have a young team. Three out of our four freshmen that we brought in were all rookie team in the Patriot League. Jalen Andrews, Kenny Jones as a sophomore. Those were sophomores last year. So, you know, that's a good piece of our core. You know, Kashmir Ochiaka didn't play a minute last year. You know, he redshirted the entire year. Santi only played 10 games. And so there's a need and a desire to help those guys get better and master their craft. Because from a talent standpoint, you know, I wouldn't trade our talent with anyone, but we got work to do. And we have some things to put in place to help ensure our success. And, you know, we just want that opportunity. But as we've talked about, you know, we want to do it safely. We want to do it right. I'm appreciative of our campus leadership. I'm appreciative of our athletic administration, Donna and her team. You know, they're doing what needs to be done to keep our student athletes safe, to keep our coaches, staff, and administrators safe. And, you know, at the end of the day, that's what's most important. We'll figure out this basketball stuff. Obviously, I'm anxious about it. I've touched on all those different aspects, but their safety is priority. And I'm grateful for the leadership on campus that they're putting all those things first and foremost.
I know I can speak for a lot of people when I say we're looking forward to the great things, the Loyola great things that you, your program and your athletes are going to bring on the court and off the court in this upcoming season. You know, this has just been really wonderful stuff that you've been talking about, and just exciting for the program and us moving forward. And really want to thank you for your time and everything that you've been doing and will continue to do for Loyola.
All right. Thank you. Thank you for having me.